So we come to the topic of nutrition. Nutrition is defined as the science of food and its relationship with health. Science of food and its relation with health. Then I introduce another term, dietetics. Dietetics. What is this? This is the practical application of the principles of nutrition. Practical application of principles of nutrition. Then I come to that. I'll introduce two terms which I'm sure you have heard: green revolution and white revolution. Can you tell who is the father of green revolution in India? Dr. C. Subramaniam. And who is the father of white revolution in India? Dr. Varghese Kurien. Green revolution is with respect to wheat and other different crops, and white revolution is with respect to milk. Next, we will discuss proteins. Now, proteins, the word protein by derivation means that which is first of importance. Pro means what? First. Huh? So, the term protein from the word pro, it means first. So obviously it means that they are very important. From the name only we can know that they are very important. Now there are 20 essential, there are 20 amino acids, of which 9 are called essential. Why they are called essential? Because the body cannot synthesize them in amounts corresponding to their needs. Okay, so what are the essential amino acids? L square, I, V, T, P, M. Lysine, leucine, isoleucine, valine, tryptophan, phenylalanine, methionine. So these are the essential amino acids. L square I, VTP. Next, what are the proteins essential for newborns and premature babies? Cysteine and tyrosine. Now, how will you know when is a protein called biologically complete? When can a protein be considered biologically complete? A protein is said to be biologically complete if it contains all the essential amino acids in amounts corresponding to the human needs. Means, suppose these are the 19 essential amino acids, and I need the first one is in, say, the human body needs the first one in, say, X concentration, the second one in Y concentration, third one in Z concentration. Okay, now a protein which will contain all the essential amino acids and in the concentration in which they are needed in the body, those proteins are called biologically complete proteins. And if one or more essential amino acids are lacking in the protein, then it is said to be incomplete. Now the question arises, you must have heard that animal proteins are considered to be superior than vegetable proteins. Why? The answer lies in what I had said just now. Animal proteins are tend to be more complete proteins, whereas plant proteins are tend to be more incomplete proteins. So obviously animal proteins are better. Next, proteins supply energy of 4 kilocalorie per gram of protein. Okay. Next are the sources. Sources, once again, animal source, plant source. What are the animal sources? Egg is considered a reference protein. Egg is very important. And vegetable sources are found in pulses, cereals, beans, nuts. These are the important vegetable sources. Next, we come to the concept of supplementary action of proteins. This is a very important topic. What is supplementary action of proteins? Cereals are found to be deficient in lysine and threonine. Cereals are deficient in lysine, threonine. Whereas pulse proteins are deficient in methionine. Pulses are deficient in methionine. Okay, so these are the known limiting amino acids of these food materials. So cereals are deficient in lysine and threonine, pulses are deficient in methionine. Now, in India, all over India, we eat rice and dal together. When we eat rice and dal, rice is what? Rice is basically a cereal. Dal is what? Dal is basically a pulse. So when you eat rice and dal together, you obtain high grade protein. Why? Because of the supplementary action of proteins. Means what? It means that the methionine which is deficient in dal, we get it from the rice, whereas the lysine and threonine which are deficient in the rice, we get it from the dal. So rice and dal is a very good combination to eat. So that is the reason why we tend to eat rice and dal. Next is, how will you evaluate proteins? Proteins can be evaluated on two fronts, there quantitatively as well as qualitatively. Now, for quantitative evaluation, for qualitative evaluation, there are two types: net protein utilization and biological value. And for quantitative, there is protein energy ratio. So how will you evaluate? Quality and quantity. When I say quality, I say net protein utilization, which says nitrogen retained by the body by nitrogen intake into 100. Net protein utilization means, suppose we take a food and we eat, say, 100 nitrogen molecules. By example, we are eating 100 nitrogen molecules. And say 60 nitrogen molecules are retained and 40 come out in the stool. So 60 by 100 into 60, that is 60% is the net protein utilization. So this is a measure of the qualitative measure of the protein. Another formula for net protein utilization is biological value into digestibility coefficient by 100. I'll explain it later on. So these are the two formulae for net protein utilization. So on an average, the net protein utilization of Indian diets lies between 50 to 80%. Next is protein quantity. Protein quantity can be expressed by the protein energy ratio, PE ratio. Here what is happening? Energy from the protein by total energy from the diet into 100 means protein energy ratio is equal to energy from the protein by energy from the diet into 100. That is the method of quantitative estimation of proteins. So I told how to evaluate proteins qualitatively and quantitatively. Next, I come to carbohydrates. Okay, fats. What are fats and what are oils? Fat is basically solid at 20 degrees centigrade. Oil is liquid at 20 degrees centigrade. This is the basic difference between fat and oil. Now, fats can be, fatty acids are of two types, saturated and unsaturated. And there is something called essential fatty acids. So essential fatty acids are those which fatty acids which cannot be synthesized by the body in humans. So what is the most important essential fatty acid? Most important essential fatty acid is linoleic acid. Okay, linoleic acid. Where it? What is the dietary source? The dietary source is safflower oil. Most important essential fatty acid. Other fatty acids which are essential are arachidonic acid and linolenic acid. Then, what are visible fats and invisible fats? Fats which are visible fats are those which that are separated from their natural source. Example, ghee from milk, cooking oils from seeds and nuts. So it is very easy to estimate their quantity. And whereas invisible fats are those fats which are not visible basically. We never consider them only, but they are also fats. Like, they are present in almost every article of food, like cereals, pulses, milk, eggs. These are invisible fats. Next, we come to the concept of trans fats. Trans fats are geometrical isomers of the cis unsaturated fatty acids. So this is a trans fat. So they are basically geometrical isomers of a cis unsaturated fatty acids. So partial hydrogenation process used to increase the shelf life of polyunsaturated fatty acids create the trans fats. Now these trans fats are considered to be more atherogenic than saturated fats, because they not only increase LDL, they also decrease HDL. So basically trans fats are even worse than saturated fats. Then what is refining of oil? Refining is usually done by treatment with steam, alkali, etc. So what is refining basically? Refining and deodorization of the raw oils is done mainly to remove the free fatty acids and rancid materials. So what they are doing? We remove the free fatty acids and rancid substances. So in refined oil, we remove the free fatty acids and rancid substances. But we should remember that refining does not bring about any change in the unsaturated fatty acids. Unsaturated fatty acid content of the oil means if one oil contains a mixture of unsaturated fatty acid and saturated fatty acid, after refining also the ratio of the unsaturated and the saturated will remain constant. They will not have any effect on the unsaturated content of the fatty acid. They just improve the quality and the taste of the oil. That is refined oil. Next, what is phenoderma? Phenoderma is deficiency of essential fatty acids. If there is a deficiency of essential fatty acids, we get phenoderma. What is happening here? There is rough and dry skin, and there is toad skin, means the skin of the person becomes toad-like and warty and rough. So that is phenoderma. It is common in Karnataka, Kerala and Gujarat. And it is characterized by horny papular eruptions on the posterior and the lateral aspect of the limbs. And how will you treat it? Obviously, it is a deficiency of essential fatty acid. So it can be treated rapidly by administering safflower oil, which will have linoleic acid. Next is the topic of, can you tell me the minimum intake of visible fat in India? 20 to 40 gram per day. Okay. Next, if I ask you, what is the best choice of cooking oil? What will you tell me? Best way to choose cooking oil is, number one, use combination. Means, blend two or more vegetable oils in 1:1 ratio. Don't use one single oil. Number two, decrease butter, ghee. Okay. Number three, decrease THVO. Means basically, I'm talking of vanaspati, dalda. Decrease it. And number four, better yet, replace THVO. Don't use it only. Use something else. So this is the Park has given these such suggestions for choosing a cooking oil. This combination: avoid using butter and ghee, and avoid using THVO, and better yet, replace THVO. Next, carbohydrates. They are the main source of energy. Carbohydrates give 4 kilocalorie per gram. Okay. Next is dietary fiber. Now, what are dietary fibers? Dietary fibers are basically the remnants of edible parts of plants that are resistant to digestion and absorption by the human intestine and reach the terminal part of the human intestine, means they reach the large intestine with incomplete or partial fermentation. Means they are basically remnants of the edible parts of the plants that are resistant to digestion. They will not undergo digestion or absorption, and they will reach the large intestine and there with only partially fermented procedure. So they will go through the entire gut and they will reach the large intestine in a partially fermented state. They will not undergo any absorption or any digestion on the way. So that is, those are fibers. Answer. Animal foods as a rule do not contain any fiber. Why we should eat fiber? Because fibers reduced coronary heart disease, coronary artery disease. Okay, and the mechanism of action is considered to be the binding of bile acids, bile salts, and preventing its reabsorption and thus reducing the cholesterol level. So they basically bind with bile salts, so decrease cholesterol. They bind to bile salts and prevents its reabsorption, thus reducing the cholesterol level in the circulation. Spark has also given most effective way for reducing the blood glucose and cholesterol level. Most effective way to decrease blood glucose and cholesterol. Fenugreek seeds. They contain 40% fibers and they are the most effective way to decrease blood glucose and cholesterol. Next, we come to the topic of vitamins. First vitamin is vitamin A. So, first of all, let me tell you, name the vitamin disease, vitamins which are no deficiency disease has been yet known. No deficiency disease in which vitamin? Vitamin E. Okay. No deficiency disease has been till yet discovered in the vitamin E. So, first is vitamin A. Vitamin A source is animal source and plant source, as we know. Animal source is liver oils, and plant sources are green leafy vegetables. And the most important carotenoid is beta. It has got carotenoids, and the most important carotenoid is beta carotene, which has the highest vitamin A activity. Okay, beta carotene. And then there are deficiency diseases caused by vitamin A, that is night blindness, conjunctival xerosis, bite out spots, corneal xerosis, keratomalacia. So these are the deficiency symptoms of vitamin A. Next. Then there is vitamin D, vitamin E, tocopherol, vitamin K, and there is the vitamin B group, B complex, B12, niacin, B5, B6, B5, pantothenic acid, folate, B12, and then vitamin C and minerals. Tell me, let us do vitamin C. Which are the species, tell me, which are the species which require vitamin C? Man, monkey, guinea pig. They are the only animals which have been known to require vitamin C. Why vitamin C is needed? Because it is an antioxidant. Vitamin C, by reducing ferric to ferrous, facilitates the absorption of iron. So basically, it should be taken along with iron for anemia. Amla or Indian gooseberry is one of the richest sources. Guava is again a cheap but rich source of vitamin C. Deficiency will cause scurvy and subcutaneous bruises. Requirement is 40 milligram per day. Then we come to vitamin B12. B12 is an organometallic compound with a cobalt atom. So it is called cyanocobalamin. B12 is not found in vegetable source. It has got only synthesized by bacteria in the colon. And it has got liver is the animal source. Liver is the main source. Okay. Deficiency will cause megaloblastic anemia, demyelinating lesions in the spinal cord, and infertility. And then in normal adults, the required dose is 1 microgram per day. Pregnancy, it is 1.2 microgram per day. Lactation is 1.5 microgram per day. Then there is folate. Basically folate. The word folate comes from what? Foliage. Means major source is green leafy vegetables. And other sources are egg, milk, fruits, wheat, meat, liver. Okay. One important point is overcooking will destroy it. Destroyed by overcooking. Folate will be destroyed by overcooking. What is the dose required? Minimum dose per day. Healthy adults, 200 microgram per day. Pregnancy, 500 microgram per day. Lactation, 300 microgram per day. Then there is vitamin B6, pyridoxine. Pyridoxine deficiency is associated with peripheral neuritis. So it is INH, an anti-tubercular drug, you know INH, is an antagonist of this B6. So patients receiving INH should be given supplement of pyridoxine. Otherwise, they will also develop peripheral neuritis. Why they will develop? Because B6 deficiency causes peripheral neuritis. Next, it's B3, niacin. B3 or niacin or nicotinic acid is essential for the normal functioning of the skin, intestine and nervous system. It causes, deficiency causes 3D, dermatitis, diarrhea, dementia. And daily required dose is 6 mg per 1000 kilocalorie of energy intake. Next is B2 or riboflavin. What is the deficiency disease? Angular stomatitis. Then there is B1 or thiamine. What are the sources? Milk is an important source, and another important source is rice. Now, we must know that thiamine is lost from rice by the process of milling. Okay, and further loss occurs due to washing and cooking. So we should avoid eating milled rice, because by milling, the thiamine is lost. Deficiency will cause beriberi. What are the types of beriberi? There is dry beriberi, wet beriberi and infantile beriberi. Dry beriberi will cause dry, so neurological, that is peripheral neuritis. Wet beriberi, wet means what? Blood. So cardiovascular system. So heart involvement. Infantile beriberi is seen in between 2 to 4 months. Affected baby is usually breastfed by the thiamine deficient mother who shows signs of peripheral neuropathy. Then also Wernicke's encephalopathy can be seen in alcoholics. Then we come to vitamin K. Vitamin K, three types are there: K1, K2, K3. K1 is mainly found in fresh green leafy vegetables. Cow's milk is also a rich source. K2 is found in intestinal bacteria. Now, vitamin K deficiency, the prothrombin content of blood is markedly decreased and blood clotting time is prolonged. So, what is happening? First of all, two types are there, K1, K2. Okay, and K1 is found in green leafy vegetables, particularly dark colored, and K2 is found in produced by intestinal bacteria. Okay, in the deficiency, what is happening? The blood clotting time is increased. Next is vitamin E. Vitamin E is tocopherol. No deficiency disease has been recognized in vitamin E. So this ends. We come to the end of the vitamin part. Next, we go on to minerals. What are the minerals? Can be major, trace, and trace contaminants. So मेजर मिनरल्स बोथ आर ट्रेस. व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस देन? दिस इज ट्रेस एलिमेंट्स एंड दिस इज ट्रेस कॉन्टामिनेंट्स. मेजर एलिमेंट्स, ट्रेस एलिमेंट्स, ट्रेस कॉन्टामिनेंट्स. व्हाट आर द मेजर एलिमेंट्स? फॉस्फोरस, सोडियम, पोटेशियम, मैग्नीशियम. व्हाट आर ट्रेस एलिमेंट्स? दीज आर रिक्वायर्ड बाय द बॉडी इन स्मॉल क्वांटिटी लाइक आयरन, आयोडीन, फ्लोरीन, जिंक. आयरन, आयोडीन, फ्लोरीन, जिंक. ट्रेस कॉन्टामिनेंट्स आर विच हैव दे डोंट हैव एनी फंक्शन बेसिकली. सो व्हाट आर देम? दे लेड, बेरियम, बोरॉन, मर्करी, एल्यूमिनियम. दीज आर द ट्रेस कॉन्टामिनेंट्स. Next, we come to iodine. Very important topic. Blood level, the adult human body contains about 50 milligrams of iodine. Okay, adult human body has got 50 milligrams of iodine, and the blood level is about 8 to 12 micrograms per deciliter. Then what are the sources? Source is seafood, cod liver oil. Seafood, cod liver oil. Next, what are goitrogens? Goitrogens are chemicals. What are goitrogens? Are chemicals that cause goiter basically. Chemicals that cause goiter. Goitrogens are chemicals that cause goiter. So, what are the important vegetables which cause which act as goitrogens? The brassicaceae group, brassica group of vegetables means cabbage, cauliflower, they contain goitrogens. So, I'll give the example. Brassica group of vegetables. Okay. And what are the components, means what are the chemicals which cause which act as goitrogens? Thiocyanate and cyanoglycoside. What are the chemicals that cause goiter? Thiocyanate, cyanoglycoside. Next, we come. So the spectrum of iodine deficiency disorders. The spectrum of iodine, according to WHO, they are called iodine deficiency disorders are called endemic if the prevalence of the goiter in school children is less than 5%. Okay, so when iodine deficiency disorders are considered to be endemic, they are considered endemic if the number of prevalence of goiter in school children is more than 5%. Greater than 5% in school children, then if the prevalence of IDD is greater than 5% in school children, then it is called endemic. School children, IDD greater than 5%, endemic. Okay, next, what are the spectrum of the iodine deficiency disorders? They are goiter, grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, multinodular. Okay, then hypothyroid. Okay, then there is strabismus, means squint. Then there is nystagmus, spasticity, neuromuscular weakness, cretinism, intrauterine death. So these are the spectrum. Also other things are there, like decreased intelligence, delayed milestones. So what is the spectrum? Goiter grade 1, 2, 3, hypothyroidism, squint, nystagmus, spasticity, neuromuscular weakness, cretinism, intrauterine death, decreased intelligence, delayed motor milestones, mental retardation, hearing defects, speech defects. So this is the spectrum of iodine deficiency disorders. Next, what is the daily requirement in adults? The daily requirement is in adults, according to WHO, is 250 microgram per day during pregnancy. So the recommendation of WHO of is 250 microgram per day during pregnancy, and normal adults is what? 50 microgram per day. This is the normal requirement of iodine per day. Next, we continue with iodine deficiency disorder and talk about in detail. We talk in more detail about the different iodine deficiency disorders. First, tell me, world's largest goiter belt is where? World's largest goiter belt is in Himalayas. Himalayan goiter belt is the world's largest goiter belt. It extends for 2400 kilometers from Kashmir to Naga Hills in the east. Next, how to control goiter? How to control goiter? First, iodinized. I stands for iodinized. This is I, not one. Iodinized salt. It is the most widely used prophylactic method for public health for against endemic goiter. So Indian Food Adulteration Act, Prevention of Food Adulteration Act, says that the concentration of iodine should be greater than 30 ppm parts per million ppm at the production point, and it should not be less than 15 ppm at consumer level. Okay, next is 2-in-1 salt. National Institute of Nutrition in Hyderabad has come up with a common salt which is fortified with iron and iodine. So that is 2-in-1 fault, salt. What is the concentration? Iron in each gram, means per gram salt, what, how much iron will be there? Amount of iron is 1 gram. Amount of iodine is 40 microgram. Next, iodinized oil. Here what we are doing, we are giving intramuscular injection of iodinized oil. Okay, where do you get the oil? The oil is from poppy seeds. Okay, also sunflower oil and safflower oil can also be used. 1 ml will protect it for 4 years. Will protect for 4 years. It is expensive, but it can be applied rapidly. Then there is oil. This was oil injection. Then there is oil oral. Now, then the third one, then another method of goiter control is monitoring. What is the best way of monitoring environmental iodine deficiency? Best method to monitor environmental iodine deficiency is neonatal hypothyroidism. By neonatal hypothyroidism, it is the best method of developing, of measuring environmental iodine deficiency. So what is the best method of measuring environmental iodine deficiency? Neonatal hypothyroidism. Next is manpower training. It is vital for this is very vital for the success of the program, that health workers and others are engaged in the program to be fully trained in all aspects of goiter control, including legal enforcement and public education. Next is mass communication and hazards of iodinization that has to be prevented. Next is mass communication. So that brings us to the end of the topic of iodine. Another important topic is fluorine. What are the diseases caused by fluorine? Dental fluorosis, skeletal fluorosis, Chenu valgum, these are the three types. What is dental fluorosis? Excessive fluoride ingestion during the early years of tooth calcification in the first 7 years can cause mottling of the teeth. Mottling, when it will occur? If exposure is before 7 years. Okay, where is it seen best? It is seen in upper incisors. Next is skeletal fluorosis. There is heavy deposition in the skeleton. And next is Chenu valgum. Fluorosis is characterized by Chenu valgum and osteoporosis. It is common among people whose staple diet is jowar. Chenu valgum is common among people whose staple diet is jowar. How can you prevent it? How can you prevent fluorosis? By changing the water source, by Nalgonda technique. What do you do in Nalgonda technique? Basically, NERI of Nagpur, National Environmental Engineering Research Institute and Research Institute in Nagpur, developed a technique of removing fluoride by chemical treatment. This is called Nalgonda technique of defluoridation of water. It involves addition of two chemicals like lime or alum in sequence, followed by flocculation, sedimentation and filtration. So also what you are doing here. What do we add? Alum line. Then we do flocculation, sedimentation, filtration. This is Nalgonda technique. Now, how do you remember? It can get quite confusing, which is first and which is later. Remember, F, it is like a sandwich. S is sandwiched between two FSF. Flocculation, sedimentation, filtration. You add alum and lime, then you do flocculation, then you do sedimentation, then you do filtration. That is Nalgonda technique.